5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you this evening. I was I was just laughing about the comments from from Friday's show. Yeah, I made the comment, there's some drinking game out there now. Every time I say I appreciate, people take shots, and I was kind of messing with the audience, saying I appreciate as much as I could to get the audience loaded. And some of the comments are pretty funny. If you get a chance, go to SasquatchChronicles.com. And check it out. Friday's show was cool. If you missed it, spoke to three separate witnesses who have had three completely different encounters, one-time encounters, fascinating encounters. And I want to thank my guest for coming on Friday. If you've had an encounter, shoot me an email, wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. My guest tonight, I'll be talking with Tony Burke, who is a researcher. He's still a truck driver, but he had an encounter while he was out, driving truck, and it got him involved into the research. He'll be coming up shortly. My first guest, though, tonight is Eric, and Eric actually had, three separate encounters. And, Eric, thanks for coming on the show. I really do appreciate you being here tonight.
Oh, you're welcome.
And I know your son kind of pushed you to, come on the show, so I want to thank him for listening, and I was really interested in the encounters. There's three separate encounters that you sent me. I guess we can kind of start with the first one. If you would, just kind of tell us what you guys were out doing. Walk us right into it. Tell us what you experienced.
I was living out in Lake Tahoe, right on the east shore of the lake on, US 50, and it goes through a tunnel down to Stateline where all the casinos are. And I was working at the Gold Nugget Casino at night, running a crane, probably 2, 3, 4 days a week for the Nevada generator systems. They had in the paper that, I guess the guy's name was Clark. He was going to try to run a jet boat at 500, 600, whatever miles per hour he could get out of it. And Lake Tahoe's real nice and flat. I mean, when it looks like glass. And a buddy of mine, Mike, and I, we went down to Manny's Cave Rock, which is on the other side, the south side of the tunnel. We walked in and we said, asked Manny and Pat if we could go up on top of the rock. And they said, no problem. So Mike and I climbed to the top. And Mike had told Manny and Pat, come on up with us. And they said, well, we got stuff to do. We'll be up there in a little while if we can. Well, we got to the top and we heard them start to come up the trail. And I was sitting there drinking a beer. I was 21 at the time, so it was legal. And the guy had ran one run. And I mean, when he went across that lake, he was scooting. They wanted to see it. Of course, Wild World of Sports and a bunch of TV cameras were down by the lake, and we had a cut. We couldn't really see to the north, but down to the south we could see. Manny and Pat got to the top, and Mike and I both looked over our shoulders, and behind Manny and Pat, there was this huge monster. I mean, it was back there probably 60, 70 feet. We looked at each other, and it was gone when we looked back. And Manny and Pat looked at us and like, what the hell's wrong with you guys? And we both said, nothing. We're just watching the boat. That, I mean, Mike and I never said a word. We just looked at each other, and even after we left, after the boat exploded, the boat hit up on the second run or third run, the boat hit a stick in the water and blew up. And we were like freaking out, so we all went down the hill. Swank and I went back to the marina and told them that the guy had hit a log or a stick or whatever, because we could see it from our vantage point. Well, we never said anything, and we just went on about our business. Now, my girlfriend at the time, she'd taken off. She got married to some guy in the Air Force, some captain or whatever. And I didn't have a ride to work every night, and I would call Pat. I used to walk because it was only about 3 miles. And I would call Pat or Manny if I couldn't get a ride from where I was at. And I wasn't going to walk that way anymore. And I always got a ride to work. But I would run down there. We kept the crane at the Safeway. I'd go down there and fire that thing up, but I couldn't drive it back to as my personal vehicle. But that's the first one.
And this is 1980. Can you kind of describe for the audience what you saw?
It was, well, when we look back over our shoulders, there's a huge rock that, on me, it came up to just above my crotch. This thing was standing back behind there, and its knees, we couldn't see its knees. And we looked at it, and its arms were kind of down at its side, and then it started to raise its arms. And that's when we looked at each other. I mean, its face was like expressionless. It didn't look like a monkey. I mean, it looked like a huge, hairy person. And I mean, the muscles. You know, I'm 6'6", and I had been out of the Marine Corps for about a year. And I was pretty well ripped, and not too many people would take me on. Same thing with Swank. Swank was a biker. He was probably 6'3". But this thing, I walked behind that rock, and he just, you know, looked at me, and he shook his head. Swank never said anything. He just shook his head and walked on down the hill. And I never bothered looking. I didn't want to go follow what the hell this thing was. Never asked anybody. Never made a comment. Just stored it away and wanted to forget it. That was it. It was able to move so quick, and we just turned our heads to look at each other, looked back, and it was gone. That was it.
Did you and your friend ever talk about it?
No, we never said, never. I mean, we used to go up to Kings Beach. We'd go to Auburn. We'd go to Sacramento. And I'd have to go down there and drop the boom truck off, not a crane, but drop it off, and we would do hospitals and things like that. And he would pick me up and act as my oiler and come back to Tahoe, or we'd stay in Kings Beach. We never said a word about it.
And how many years later was your second incident?
That was, it was probably 86. I was back here in Indiana, and we were doing a Otis Elevator over in Bloomington. It shut down for, I think, 2 weeks. And we were doing 7 days a week, 12 hours a day. And what my job was to change out the crane rails that were in the loading bay. And I had a little 10-ton crane in there. My cousin was getting married in Columbus, which is about 50 miles away from Otis Elevator. And I made it out with Jack Neely for him to take over for me so I can go to the wedding and then scoot back as quick as possible so that we didn't lose any hours to somebody else. So I got off at midnight. And I jumped in the van and started coming across 46, which goes to a little town called Nashville. And there's this, probably the largest state park in Indiana, Brown County State Park. And we'd always had, you know, picnics and parties and go fishing and things like that. There's a good place. As I'm coming up to the entrance, Brown County State Park, I see a guy doing jumping jacks in the middle of the road. I mean, I'm like, what the hell is this dude doing? And so I slowed down. He was trying to get me to stop. And when I stopped, I always carried a Mossberg Persuader and a Rugar 1022 with me. And I figured maybe this guy's trying to set me up. I've heard about that before. So I just pulled out the Rugar 1022. And I didn't unlock the passenger door. And he's going, let me in, let me in. I get out. And he's going, there's something up on the hill. Now, 46 is a two-lane highway, but it has wide berms. So it could actually probably be a slow-moving four-lane. But then on the north side, there's this huge ditch, and then this hill that goes up probably 15, 18 feet. And it's all a rock face. It's where they probably blast away to remove for the roadbed and for proper drainage. And something was up there making one hell of a bunch of noise. And this dude said, that thing's been following me. I don't know what it is. It's throwing rocks. Right about then, here comes a slab. You know what sandstone is, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That's what came down, and it hit and scooted across the road. And I was like, what in the hell is that? And I'm looking, and I don't see anything. And I said, dude, let's just get... And then it started going off, making all kind of crazy-ass noises. And I just jumped in, unlocked the door, and I had a 360 in this van, and I stomped on the gas. We got the hell out of there, and I'm looking in rear view, and there's something in the middle of the road. Now, I'm probably about 200 yards away from it by this time, but I mean, it's still in the road, and it looked pissed, but it looked big, too.
What kind of noises was it making?
It was making, you've heard mountain lions, right? You know, it was doing something like that, only it was lower. It was rattling the trees. There's a whole lot of trees up there. It was making all kinds of noise, and it was intimidating this dude. He'd been working downtown Nashville, and what he was going to do is just walk the back roads by the fairgrounds. And then he was going to go up over the hill to where the hotel was. But he wasn't familiar with the area. He walked past that and came out all the way to the Brown County State Park. And there's a little road right there. And he was like, took him a long time. He could have probably got a ride a lot earlier if he would have known the path. But he said after he passed that one road, that's where this thing picked up on. And it just paralleled him and followed him all the way out to the road, staying back in the trees. And there's a couple cabins back up there. And I guess there was nobody in them, but he said he was scared really bad. And it was so bad when we started driving away, I smelled something. And I looked at him, and he goes, I shit my pants. And I carried basketball stuff with me. I had sweatpants and shorts and stuff, and we went up to the store up by the KOA campground, and he went in, changed his clothes, and I took him all the way back to Greensburg. I mean, I didn't get back to Columbus till about 3 o'clock in the morning.
Did he ever say what he thought it was?
No. I never even asked the dude his name, and he didn't ask me his. All I said was, what is that smell? And then I gave him some clothes, and I was like, take that crap off, put it in the bag, and, you know, I said, I'll take you home. We never talked about it. It was the same thing as the first one. I wasn't going to say anything. I'm a crane operator. If I say something like that, they're going to be drug testing me.
I wanted to ask you, as you were driving off and you see this thing in your rearview mirror, was it on two legs or was it on four, or could you tell?
It was standing up. Oh, I could tell, no problem. And it never popped into my head that this was the same thing that I saw before. You know, since then, I've been thinking back and trying to remember, and I'm like, I think it's probably the same species or whatever, but, you know, it's a great big river monkey.
And then you had a third encounter. How many years later was this third one?
About 5 weeks ago.
And if you would, just walk us right into it. What happened in that encounter?
Well, I was standing right behind the house, and I had the puppy and Jack out here, let them do their business. And all of a sudden, back in the woods, probably 350, 400 yards away from where I'm standing, I heard coyotes going like crazy. Well, I've heard that before, and they're taking a deer down. So I throw the dogs back in the house, get in the office, grab me a shotgun, put five rounds in the tube and two in my pocket, and I start huffing back there. And I went around to the back side of the lake, and I was going to cross the creek. It was too overgrown, and I hadn't been back there since spring. And so I followed the creek down to the culvert, and across the culvert, there's a big opening up there. It's probably 150 foot from the culvert to the first tree, maybe a little bit further, but it's probably 75, 80 foot across. And it's pretty well open. There's a little bit of volunteer trees. But when I got in there, I didn't hear the coyotes anymore. And I figured they got the deer down and they're chowing on it. And so I started, you know, sneaking back there. And I passed this one tree that's like a big fir or a cedar tree, but the limbs go all the way to the ground. And so you can't really see what's behind it. And there's this little opening, probably 40, 50 foot by 30 foot. And then there's another stand of trees and then some big brush on the right-hand side and then a forest on the left. And I got up there and I'm right in the middle of it. And I'm looking at this tree in front of me and I'm like, where's the damn coyotes? And all of a sudden I hear a deer snort. Deer snorts, they're, you know, pretty common. Then I heard a deer snort to my right. And I'm like, what is... And then they started going back and forth. And it started to sound like an engine going back and forth. And I'm like, what in the heck's going on? And then I realized something is moving to my left flank. And I start looking that way and I point the shotgun towards that way. And then there's a snort over there. And those two stop. And then they start snorting like crazy. And I can hear something moving through the bush off to my right flank. And I'm like, I don't like this. And I heard whatever it was got all the way behind me. And he's behind that tree. That's when I popped around it. And that's when they started doing the big time snorting back and forth and then making other little noises. And I'm like, I've never heard this before. I'm starting to freak out. And so I just yelled out, I'm getting out of here, because I thought it was maybe somebody playing with me. But by that time, it's pretty much dark. The sky is still a little bit blue, but I can't see anything in the woods. And so I back out, and I keep fanning the shotgun around. And whatever was behind me followed me to the west as all the way as I went out. And when I crossed over the culvert, I was probably 50 foot past the culvert. Whatever it was, either jumped or stepped across that creek and broke a huge branch. And I made a phone call. I called my aunt. I said, get the shot or get the 30-06 out. I'm coming up there. I'm coming back down here to see what this is. And as I'm on the phone, one of the rocks that we use back on the dam, which is a big, 2.5-pound rock, it comes flying over my head. And I'm like, oh, shit. And that's what I said to my aunt. She says, what did you say to me? And I says, a rock just flew over my head. I says, I got to go. And I hightailed it back up to the house, and I went in to talk to them. In the meantime, I called my son, and he says, coyotes? They eat coyotes. And I'm like, why would they eat coyotes? They probably taste like dogs. And, but he explained it to me, and I was like, okay. So I settled down, and I came back to my house, and I'm covered with furs. I mean, I look like I'm in a ghillie suit. I'm like, gee, many Christmas. And Luke calls me back and says, why don't you go down to the lake, take the spotlight, go down to the lake, and sit on the dock and just listen and see if you can hear anything going across in the woods. And I was like, okay, that sounds like a good idea. So I stepped out on the back porch, and I had a K-bar with me, no weapon. And I had my little spotlight. And as I was standing on the porch, I lit a cigarette, and on the side of our house, it was like something had smacked the crap out of one of the big trees. I've got three big trees over there. And I mean, it made a crack, not quite as loud as a rifle going off, but it was loud enough that it startled me. And I ran around the corner real quick to see what it was. And I'm shining the spotlight, and I'm shining it up in the tree. And I'm like, what in the hell's, you know, there's no wind. What is that? And I called my aunt, and I said, turn on the security lights. And it's just light up like a fortress. And so she went and lit it up, and I walked back to the shotgun. And as she turned the lights on, something ran between the houses, down the swale, and then back out towards this, I have a fern pile back here. And I got that shotgun, and I put double-aught buckshot and then slugs. And then I put two slugs in my pocket, and I put one in the pipe. And I started walking back out here, shining and spotting. And I'm looking, and I start hearing clicking. Like, can you hear that?
Yeah, like, are you talking about, like, tongue pops?
Yeah. Tongue clicking. And I'm like, what in the hell is this? And I'm not quite to the back of the barn, but I'm hearing this, and I can't see anything. Whatever it is behind the pile. And then I hear down by the edge of the pond, I hear a bird call, and I'm like, it's night, whatever that is. And then I heard a second one over to the, by Johnson's farm. And I'm like, uh-oh, whatever it is, they're converging. And then Luke calls up, and I tell him what's going on. And he says, get the hell out of there. Just get to the house. So I just retreated back to the house, and I unloaded the weapon, and I locked the doors. Well, about then, somebody to the west of us, we got a subdivision probably a quarter mile to the west. Somebody starts shooting. Now, by this time, it's completely black outside. Completely dark. And whoever's shooting is shooting a lot. My uncle calls me up and says, are you shooting? And I said, no. And I said, I think it's over at Blackout. He says, go over and check it out. So I get in the van and I drive over there. By then, there was two cops, and one of them was pulling out. The other one had a pistol in his hand, and he's talking to a guy. And the guy is pointing back to the woods, and I'm like, oh, hold on. You know, I'm not going to stop and talk to the cop. I got the shotgun in the car. So I went around, came back, and Luke says, on Sunday, the next day, go out in the woods and see what you can see. I'm like, all right, I'm going to take the 30-ounce shake. Now, the next day, about 11 o'clock, I got out there, and it just felt normal. And I went all the way to the west end of the property, about 400 or 500 yards. And there wasn't really anything. It was right back behind Blackout. And I went all the way to the east end, just back to where I had originally had this weird-ass encounter. And there were parts and pieces of coyote. There's about three skulls. I should say heads. And then there were the front part, and it was like they had been torn, you know, pulled apart. And I was like, whatever it was, I don't want to meet it. And I swung back around, and I went over by Morales' house, which is half a mile away. And I started coming back, and I mean, it was so thick that, you know, I had a hard time getting back over here, but I eventually did, and I was like, there's nothing there. Nothing but that ripped up coyotes. And But when I got back here, one of my neighbors, I was talking to him. I was talking to Johnson. Johnson said two fences were tore down over blackout, and two dogs were missed. That's pretty much the end of that.
What part of the country are you in, Eric?
I'm in Columbus, Indiana.
Columbus, Indiana.
I mean, I'm right next to. I'm just south of 46. We've got it's probably close to three quarters, maybe more, of woods that are 400 foot or 400 yards thick, and it goes pretty much from 350 all the way to the cut through for the Turtle Bay edition.
Did you ever get a chance to talk to the neighbor?
No, I talked to one of them a few years ago. He'd posted something on BFRO. He was a senior at Columbus East High School. And Luke had found it and says, oh, can you go over and talk to him while I'm at school? And I was like, yeah, sure. And went over and I talked to the guy's dad. And he says, yeah, he saw something out here. And the reason I knew it was this addition over here is because it said a city park with a lake. And there are 11 city parks in Columbus, but only one of them has a lake, and that's right next to us. And then, oh, 2 years ago, the kids were out in the pond. I had a kayak, and they were screwing around with a kayak and a John boat. And my uncle, he calls me up and he says, come over here and take a look at this. I went over. There was something down on the other side of the dam moving back and forth. He goes, what is that? I said, I don't know. He said, go down there and check it out. And so I got down there. By the time I got there, there was nothing there. But he said, I said, what'd you see? He says, I don't know, it was something black and it's bobbing back and forth. Said, whatever. But that's been probably 3 years. But we've got Camp Atterbury is just to the north and to the west of us. And then we have what's called Columbus Youth Camp. And at the same time, I went over and talked to the guy at Black about the BFRO report. I just went ahead and drove on down to youth camp, and the guys were closing up for the night, and I said, you guys ever see anything strange around here? And they were like what? And I said, oh, I don't know, just, you know, something strange. And they were like, you mean Bigfoot? And I was like, well, yeah, and they go, yeah, they're back here. We call them river monkeys. And I was like, what?
That's interesting. So they actually call them river monkeys, huh?
Yeah, they apparently, well, then I started talking to my cousin, and I said, river monkeys, and they said, yeah, remember Grandpa used to talk about river monkeys, and that his farm is just north about 4 miles, and the river goes right through it, and he'd always, I remembered Grandma say, don't tell them that, you'll get something in their head they can't get out, and I was like, okay.
When that one ran between the home, did you actually see it, or was it more or less you could hear it running in between the houses?
I heard it, and I saw it. I've got my back porch is on the east side. It's like just a chunk taken out of the house. And the trees, I can't see them from the back porch, but I got a raspberry patch here, and then I got a big bush on the end of it. And when Evelyn turned on the lights, I saw it. It was just scooting behind that big bush, and that's when I got the shotgun and went down there, and I looked in the ravine right back behind here, and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 big trees right there. And I'm shining with one hand and I've got the shotgun in the other. That's when I heard it doing clicking over here at the burn pile. And so I came back. And I went toward the front side of the barn and then started going down the west side of the barn. And that's when I heard the damn bird call and then something else, the bird call and clicking over towards Johnson's horse pasture. And I was like, that's it. Thank God, Luke called. I'm out of here.
Yeah, I don't blame you.
There's a time to be brave. There's a time to be brave and a time to skedaddle.
Can you describe what you saw?
Well, whatever went to the burn pile, it wasn't all that big. I mean, I was thinking, okay, that's maybe my size. I'm 6'6". And the one, it was much smaller than the one I saw at Tahoe. And I really don't know how big that one was over in Brown County, but it was damn good size. Who was it? We put a timber frame up down in Paoli, and this lady paid about $250,000 for that house. And I went down there to show it a buddy of mine in the construction business. And this has been probably 91 or 92. And she had it for sale. And I asked her, why are you selling it? She says, there's something out here in the woods. I'm scared of it. I'm not staying out here anymore. And she moved. And I never knew what it was. But then there were some reports that came from Paoli that some of the truck drivers that deliver sill gas, you know, the natural gas for homes, they'd run across some of these things. And then over towards Story, which is in Brown County, south of 131, south on 135, I had a couple of buddies that deliver gas down that way. So they almost ran over one that was in the middle of the road about 4 o'clock in the morning when it was real cold out. That's been 10 years ago.
Well, definitely keep me updated on anything that's going on around that property, if you would, Eric, if you don't mind. I would love to hear if there's anything else going on around the property. Do you hear them often on your property?
Not at all. Every once, like in the fall, I think they come over to hunt whatever it is. And Luke's more up on it than I am. He's saying that, you know, coyotes and, you know, some of the other predators are in competition with them, and they're going to take them out first so that they got the deer. And Luke works at Miami University over in Oxford, Ohio, and he was living down in Riley, and he gets off at 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the morning, and he was sitting in his driveway, and he's out in the middle of nowhere. And he said he turned the radio on, and he was just sitting there chilling out. He looked over and saw knees look out of his car window, and then it walked off, and he said he didn't turn the lights on. He just watched it, and they got a security light back behind the house, and there's a tree house. It's 10 foot up in the air, and he says this thing ducked to get into the tree house. You need to talk to him, too. But we're going to...
Luke's your son.
We're going to go... Yeah, Luke's my son. He's bigger than I am.
Yeah, well, definitely keep me updated, and yeah, send me Luke's info. I would love to talk with him and talk what you know what he's experienced, and I can't thank you enough, Eric, for coming on and sharing the encounters and just all the different experiences that you had. I still think about that poor guy that you picked up that crapped himself.
He was so freaked out, man. But I mean, once we got everything taken care of down there at the Shell station, I just said, where do you live? And he says, I'm going to Greensburg. And I just took him to Greensburg. We didn't say diddly squat. About halfway between Brown County and Columbus, I turned the radio on, but we didn't say anything.
Yeah, and that's actually more common than most people realize. You would think the normal reaction would be sit there and talk about what just happened, but actually, the normal reaction is not to talk about it, just to kind of sit there. You guys are probably soaking it in mentally, you know what I mean?
No, I was like, that didn't happen. It just didn't freaking happen. You know, I think everybody's starting to see these things.
Yeah, more and more people are starting to see them, and more people are starting to come out and talk about them. You know, a lot of guys have had on recently had encounters back in the 70s, and they're just now coming out and talking about it. And talking about the things they've seen, talk about the things they've experienced. So I think you're right. I think more and more people are coming forward and wanting to share what they've seen, what they've experienced. It's becoming more mainstream, I think. Well, like I said, you know, I'd like to speak to Luke and keep me updated with everything else going on there. And thank you again for being here.
Well, you're welcome. If I can get a hold of Luke, I'll have him give you an email and tell you about that Riley thing.
Yeah, please do. Please do.
All right.
And next, let's go to Tony Burke. Again, Tony is a researcher and a truck driver that had an encounter. Tony, welcome to the show. Thank you for being here.
No problem.
Tell me about the first time you ran into a Sasquatch. Tell me about the very first encounter that you ever had. Where were you at? What were you doing? And then just kind of walk me into the encounter, if you don't mind.
Okay, well, the first one I want to tell about is me as a child up in Ohio, right on the outskirts of Bell Fountain. During the daytime, we heard we was in the kitchen in the old house, and it was way back a long lane and way down in the valley, and right, there's a creek runs alongside there. I heard on the radio that my mom and dad, everybody sitting around and listening to the radio, and I heard Bigfoot sighted in the area a few times. So I was like, I asked my dad, so where's this at? He said, it sounds like it's coming this way. You know, I put it off like, you know, I don't know if he's telling the truth or he didn't want to go to the area or whatever, but it come across that a few people sighted it and where they sighted it at. And
what year is this, Tony?
It was probably in the late 70s.
Okay. And so you guys are sitting around as a family, and you guys hear over the radio that there was a sighting nearby. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I think someone was doing dishes or something like that, you know, kitchen work or whatever. We was listening to the radio, and we was here to listen to the music, but then a news bulletin come across, and later that night, it was dark out and everything. We had some hunting dogs. We had all kinds of farm animals. And the hunting dogs started going crazy, started choking on their chains and stuff like that. And then going crazy, and Dad and everybody turned out the lights and got the gun out. And then it smelled some awful smell outside. And so everybody got quiet and everything, and we hear a loud, long breeze right alongside the walls. We right next to the walls. We hear it through a little old house. And my dad, he went outside of the gun, a flashlight, I guess. He couldn't find anything. He came back in. He said he sent us to into town that night. But we lost one of our dogs. We don't know what happened to it. We don't know if it broke the collar or broke the chain or anything. If I was right now my age, I'd be out there looking for prints, you know, not when it happened. Then we skipped to about 4 years ago, 3.5 years, 4 years ago. My dad was down from Ohio, and I drive semi now, so, and he told me about a Bigfoot that he seen in Ohio that was real tall. He said he was seriously tall, and he was running across the field, and his buddy was driving somewhere, and he told his buddy to turn around. He seen a Bigfoot, and he said he cut it off on another road, and the guy went around, he laughed at him and everything, and went to the next town over. Then they come back through. He's wondering where it was. He said, it done gone now. And my dad's had a wooden leg all his life, and he hunt, fish, trapped all his life, and he had never seen one. And that was just a coincidence. It's over there in Ohio, like about mid-Ohio. He told me that that he seen one, so I said, well, I'm driving semi now. I just started, I said, going to different states and all through the mountains and everything. I started looking, you know. I started paying attention more way out in the woods on both sides of me, as far as I can see. You know, I rode along and I've seen things, you know, thought it might be something. You know, thought it might be one or whatever. But October 2013, I picked up a load in around Duncan and Spartanburg area in South Carolina. I was coming back down 85, runs along through Hartwell Lake and into Atlanta. And right before I was heading out of South Carolina in the evening, about 4 or 5, I seen it was just a heavy downpour of rain. I mean, it was a real heavy downpour of rain. And I come out like a wall of it. And then I had my windshield wipers cleaned off, and about mile marker number 7 in Oconee County Fairplay, South Carolina. And I checked my gauges, and I looked something in my camera, my peripheral vision to the right, and I looked up, and it couldn't be no more in my face, clear, Bigfoot. It just, I've been looking, you know, running up and down that road, same road for interstate system for a long time, you know, every day, just about delivering, making deliveries to South Carolina, North Carolina, and looking both ways and everything. And this thing just happened to come right out, right in front of my semi, so alongside the bank, it's still in the grass. And I hit my brakes a little bit. I knew the car was behind me. I couldn't stop, but I could slow down. So I looked. I was looking at it as I was looking, you know, everything about it looked like a tall Chewbacca, you know. It looked like over 10 foot. It had long hair, long underneath arms like a orangutan. It's kind of wavy. And long hair in the back of the head and the neck like a horse's mane. And there's short hair all over the body, like a reddish brown, dead pine needle color. So I was sitting there watching it run. It was like a real fast walk. I mean, it's so smooth. It didn't run like a human with arms going up and down or the body, you know, rising and falling, dropping. It's just like a steady, smooth flow. And his hair was straight back like somebody's on motorcycle. And I was watching, I was thinking, you know, I know the name for it is Bigfoot or whatever, but this man is just running alongside the interstate. And I said, what's this running thing running after? And I was thinking, Bigfoot. I looked down at his feet, and I couldn't see his feet. It's all covered with hair. And then I was like, what's this thing maybe running to or whatever? I got my bumper right up next to it. I was looking over at it, and it ran straight back up into the woods. I looked back into the woods. I started to pull over, and I was like, well, I can't go in the woods with it without, you know, some kind of gun protection and everything. I wanted to get a video and just chase it and just, you know, stay on it, whatever, and I just couldn't do it. I went back to Georgia, and then I eventually got my gun carrying permit, went back, went into the area. There's old barns in that area, and old house that was for sale, been for sale for a long time. And there's barns and hay in the barns and everything. And that was the first one, October 2013. It was like early in the month. Then I really seen like one every, you know, couple months, one every month for at least a year and a half. 2014 to 2015, I've seen them in Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, and Tennessee. And I've seen one.
Is it mainly when you're on the road is when you're seeing them?
Yep, right there on like a side road or a major interstate. Seen one on the side road in Calhoun, Georgia. It was over where Trail of Tears started on 225, right off of I-75. Go east on 225, right off 75, about a mile on the right. It's got a Trail of Tears started over there in one place, and it had to keep it all cut down and everything. The old building's back in there. I told my, there's a creek running along through there too. And, a river also, and I was riding along, had my daughter in the car, I said, there's one right there. I said, look, and I don't think she's seen it. She won't look what I tell her to, and then I pulled into the entrance, and she said, no, I started getting out of cars. I had my gun, my camera on, so she wanted to go to mom's house, took her mom's house, come back, went in there, I couldn't find it. This thing was about 8-9 foot. It was black. It was missing hair on the side of his face and on the side of his arm and chest. And it was just standing there, about 3 foot off tree line, looking at the road there. It had about big black eyes, like orange, like size of oranges. And
can I ask you about your first? What? Can I ask you a question about the first encounter?
Yeah.
When you saw this thing, on the side of the road, how far away from your truck is it running?
It's probably about right there alongside the interstate, and that bank's probably about 20 foot from it. And this thing ran probably about, I say, at least 100 foot, 100, 125 foot.
Before it went off into the wood line?
I mean, I watched it. The thing probably ran about 50. I mean, it was moving along. I mean, it's 10 foot. It just looked like it wasn't even in the, you know, running as fast as it can. It was running, but it wasn't running as fast as it can. I was thinking this thing could probably run over 3 or 4 mountains, and then before it got tired, you know. I'm thinking it's more or less had mostly, you know, animal to it.
And was it on 2 legs the whole time?
Yep.
And were you able to...
It was...
Were you able to get any of the facial features when you were looking at it?
Negative on the first one. I seen the sides and seen the back of it. I got up there alongside of it, and it took right, like a diagonal, right up into the woods.
I gotcha. And then how many years later was it that you saw your second one?
Yeah, it was probably a few months later.
Okay.
And I seen that one on 225. It was, something was strange about it. It was had a bulge right there on the stomach, like it just ate, like, about the size of a basketball. I mean, it's bulged out. I got thinking, you know, a couple days later, it might have been pregnant, but it didn't have no breasts. I don't know if it just ate something, ate a dog or what. You know, I just don't know.
Like it had like a pot belly?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't a pot belly, it was a bulge.
Interesting.
And I don't know, it looked like the facial expression on it looked like it was having a rough time. But I don't know.
What did the face look like?
Face sort of looked like a human shape type face, but it had some, you know, I'd say animal kind of facial features, like a dark color, you know, it just didn't look human.
What was it mainly about the face that caught your attention?
I'm not sure. Like the missing hair on the side of it, on that one side, along the side of it. And it looked spooky, you know, the way it looked. Okay. The way it was looking towards the road. And let's see, I've seen one that was in Bessemer City, North Carolina. That's right on the I-85. A couple hours, about 2.5-3 hours right above the Oconee County, went on the same side, same interstate. And it was on the north side of 85, it was Bessemer City, North Carolina. And I was coming back with a load up there one evening. And I was looking up through the power line, and one ran down the power line. This looked like a juvenile. And it was all black. It didn't have no, it wasn't skin. It was, you know, hair. And this thing ran down the power line like a J shape out into the woods. And this thing was, it looked like it was having a good time, but it wasn't, you know, from our society and everything. It looked like he was, you know, kind of laughing, you know, having a good time. But there's just something strange about it. And I went up past one exit, went up to the next exit, turned around, went back. There's an old hotel shut down there. A lot of air conditioners out of them and everything, filled with furniture. And I parked in there. And, you know, anything crawl up in any of them places and stay warm and everything. And I walked down through the woods and searching that area, and I found a big deer down there. I think he was chasing that deer. And
now, when you say
one of above there.
What do you mean it was having a good time?
I don't know. It looked like it was, you know, a kid running down the fire line, you know, kind of full stride. It was, you know, you look at somebody, you know, it looked like it was, you know, like a human having a good time. You know?
I gotcha. So and, just the impression.
Like it was playing, maybe.
Yeah, the impression you were getting.
And, yeah.
I gotcha.
So I think it was chasing that deer down in that valley there. I couldn't find that Bigfoot anywhere, and I walked down through there, and all that place up there was right above on that next hill there. There was an old house that was there, and the window was out of it, and I looked through the window, and there was a big hole in the ceiling of it, and then I was looking around for handprints or fingerprints or anything, and I couldn't see anything. And there's a few old shacks there with hay in them and straw and, you know, whatever. And it looked like top of one barn. It looked like it might have been, you know, laid down in there, Frank. I have checked that area a few times since, you know, it snowed, thinking it might go in there where it snowed, maybe, stay warm, and looking for prints and everything. And I never found anything. But that time that I went back the first time to look for it and everything, I seen that deer down in there. I seen this kid walking from the store carrying some groceries. I told him what I was doing down over there and what I seen. And he said, well, something was throwing rocks at me the other day while I was walking through here. So I said, well, they do that, you know. I've heard of them doing that. And then I seen one evening and going across Hartwell Lake on a bridge. I looked over and this thing was floating like a foot underneath the water. It was real tall. Not sure how tall it was, but it was floating like a foot underneath the water. It was like a log underneath the water. Only thing that was above water was his head. And it was just floating across the lake, you know. I was like, there's not anybody see this, you know. I mean, it was probably about 30 yards out. And then, so I pulled over on the interstate off the side, and it's got the ripples along the side of the interstate. And that made a lot of noise, and I pushed my air brakes and made a lot of noise. And got a semi stop. That was a long ways, you know, down the road, and I had to run all the way back to the center of the bridge because I couldn't see around the bank if it went straight to the bank. So I couldn't find it. I ran up the bank to the edge of the bridge, went up the bank, and went over into the woods. I couldn't find it. And I had to go take the load to where I was going to South Carolina a certain time, so I had to go back to the truck and go on. And I seen one in Chattanooga one day. I was riding along where interstate splits at. There were some rivers and ponds and stuff in there, in that area. I've hiked it before, you know, after I seen one. But I was riding along and I seen this Bigfoot way back in this power line, way back off the road, probably about 90 yards off the road. And all I seen was a chest, about waist up, and it was black. And this thing was, it had been huge. It was wide. And I seen it. It was looking the traffic going back and forth on the interstate. I mean, no human, you know, watches interstate or any traffic like this thing does. This thing was shaking its head real fast, side to side, real fast, irregularly. And then next, there's a road cuts alongside there. Goes right alongside where during construction and everything. And this thing jumps back like it didn't want to be seen by this car. And I don't know if it's seen it or not, because I mean, I was up in the semi way at an interstate, pretty far away from it. And so about a week or so, I drove up there about 35 minutes from my house, north of me. I live on 75 there. And then I hike the area, and I find all kinds of footprints around swamps and stuff where nobody should be not wearing shoes. And I found some footprints in town where I'm at and everything. But there's all kinds of footprints around there. It's like rivers and creeks and stuff that overflood over there, and the water washing back. You know, it leaves it muddy along the sides and the banks and all through that area. And I find prints here and there and everywhere. I go up there a few times and hike up to there and everything. I started a website that I'm not sure when I started that website. Might have been the first or second sighting, but I started a website, you know, try to keep up with where they've been seen at and everything else, you know, about them and try to learn and everything. And what I found out and all the evidence I find and try to post on there. And I had people that noticed wanting to join science, so I started accepting people, you know, and I got district attorneys and police officers and coaches that want to go and, you know, want to listen, hear about everything, find out about all walks of life, you know. It's Appalachian Sasquatch and Bigfoot research. I've had people fly in and drive in, and we go hiking and everything, and I'm getting people joining every day, but...
Let me ask you this, Tony. Have you ever looked at, and I'm always, and this will be kind of some skeptical questions, so forgive me. You know, I'm surprised that more truck drivers don't see these things. I'm always shocked when I talk to a lot of truck drivers that really haven't seen anything. I would probably expect out of everyone, they would be the ones to see them. But have you ever questioned some of your sightings? And I'll give you an example. And I'm sure.
Yes, I have.
Well, I'll give you an example.
I'm questioning my sightings because we have a Comic Con down here in Atlanta. Everybody dresses up. There's Chewbacca's down there, but nobody can. I went through it over and over and over. Nobody could run like that one I seen in South Carolina. Nobody's that tall. If they're that tall, I've taught about basketball players. I said, anybody's this tall cannot run. They're not as good as the shape. Everybody who has been 10 foot or more is deformed or has to run with a cane or are not in shape. So far, you know. And
I don't mean that sighting. What I mean by that is, and I'll give you an example, and this isn't meant to question you by any means. The point I'm trying to make, when I've talked to a lot of witnesses in the past, there's a common thing that happens sometimes in the psychology of sightings, especially real sightings. Sometimes you can tell when someone almost has had a real sighting by this simple fact. I've talked to, I'll give you a perfect example. I won't say the name, but I went out to this person's property. No question in my mind that they have had legitimate sightings on their property, no question. But sometimes when I go out there, they'll go, see these two cross sticks? Sasquatch did that. And I'm just, it looks like just two sticks that fell to me. It doesn't look like anything special. Or you'll see like two or three rocks on top of each other, and they'll come by and explain to you that Sasquatch did that. And, you know, it's...
Let me tell you, I really don't know, you know. I've never seen one actually break a stick or anything, but let me tell you something about the sticks being broke. See, I drive the interstate a lot, and I know I've heard about them, you know, being broke and everything, and stick structures and stuff like that I'm interested in, but when I'm driving along the interstate and I see a broken tree when none of them on the ground is broke and everything. And it's just out in order in the area that it's broke, and it's like I'm thinking this is a sure sign that's, you know, a Bigfoot's broke that.
Well, no, the point...
I'm not sure if it's me and all the information, you know, I've had over the years and everything else, but I've actually took my GPS, and you go on aerial view, and the trees are usually broke on the opposite side of the interstate from a pond or creek. So whatever way the tree is broke, that is facing towards, is broke towards, the piece hanging down is going towards a pond. I mean, the pond might be 30, you know, 40, 50, 100 yards out, but it's broke towards a water source.
No, no, no. Here's the point I was trying to make. How long have you been driving truck?
Semi, I have been driving for about 4.5 years.
Okay.
Probably about 5 if you add on 1999 when I come out of the truck driving school for about 6 months. Then went with a concrete company for 10 years. 2009, it got laid off.
The point I'm trying to make is you saw something that changed your life. You saw something that freaked you out. You saw something that that wasn't supposed to.
It makes me want to, I used to walk out the door after seeing it. I used to walk out the door at my house, and we got woods all along the sides of it. And I'm just thinking, you know, out there in my yard, this thing could run out. One could run out, grab you, carry you off, no problem. There's woods everywhere, and people walking around. And I mean, I thought about all this stuff a long time ago. People walking around every day, doing, you know, everything, and people hiking and riding bikes and everything else, and just they just don't know. They don't know. They don't know the reality. It's just if people knew, then it would change the whole society's reality. Is outside. What outside means.
Right. I'm wondering, though, is you had that dramatic experience, and now when you're driving around, do you think that sometimes, and I ask this question very respectfully, do you think sometimes that it's somewhat post-traumatic stress of driving around, and now you look over, and it's like,
it's post-traumatic of not working 14 hours a day, which every truck driver does, is post-traumatic of what you've seen that was so close. And it's not just one, it's several. I've seen several over the years. And now I know I hike on weekends and everything, but that Chattanooga sighting, that I had an oil company owner who was interested in seeing one, or knows. He's interested in everything. I told him to come down, you know. He called, and he had to cancel out the first time. He come down the second time. He flew all the way down to Atlanta. He's a oil company owner, task company owner of a guy. He's in Wisconsin. Flew down and ran him a car. Come up to Calhoun. We met up. He has his fiance and a guy he grew up with, went to school with. And we got up the next day. Went up there in Chattanooga and hiked around. We was taking pictures of all the footprints and everything. I've taken, done casts up there and got GPS on the cast I've done and posted photos in my website. And then we went back. The guy said that he was going to bring a night vision scope. He told me what kind it was. I looked up on YouTube, figured out how to use it before he came down. And that evening, we went in there, waited till it got dark. I said, this is the other area. This is actually the area that I actually seen it at. The other areas around there is where we found, you know, all kinds of prints. So this big area in there, you walk in, it kind of overflows. And it's got like a lot of like dead vegetation. It's like a foot of it. It's a real soft area. It's real open all through there and everything. And we walk in there, and it's dark. We got one flashlight. I carry a Glock 45 with extended clip just for protection. And we walk in there. I tell them, I don't know what they're doing. You know, I ain't never been in the woods with them at night or close to them in daytime, you know, out and open, outside of the vehicle. So we walk in there, and I got a cell phone. I recorded a Bigfoot yells that I was recording in California, that a Texas guy got a response off of also. So I had it on my cell phone. I had a megaphone I bought from Radio Shack. I was on call blast, blow it through that megaphone. And we got in there, and the guy does a wood knock on a tree, a stick. This thing responds back. It must have had a stick in his hand. I don't know if they carry sticks on them or what. It happened so quick it had it must have had a stick in the hand. It would knock about 35 yards out to the left of us, in between us and the interstate. And that's the area I wanted to go in there and look through, you know, off the little path through there. You can look through there. There's a tree opening right past there where we was. And it does wood knock three times, and it responds all three times. And I think he himself, it happened so quick, I think he himself, he only heard like once or twice. Everybody else heard three. You know, he did wood knock, it knocked back. And he waited, did another wood knock, it knocked back three times. So we walk in there further, we know what's in there, and we're looking through this opening. It's a night vision scope, and you can see 100 yards. Each time you push a button on it, it goes in 30 yards. And the darker it is, the clearer you see, like a daylight through that scope. And when you pull your eye away from the scope, it's like it blinds. It's like a flashlight.
Yeah.
It's shining your eye. It takes a minute. Eye to adjust back. We're looking. We can't go back in there because it's flooded all the area that's close to us. So we're sitting there on the path looking through that opening there, and we can't see it. So I start doing some call blasting on my cell phone, playing Bigfoot Yells through that megaphone, and getting no response. I did that for about 8 minutes. And then the guy, he yells with his hands. This thing yells back. The Bigfoot yells at us. And then, this is the first time I've been in the woods with it yelling, one yell. Then not even a minute later, one yells, he's about 90 to 100 yards out on the right of us. And when this one yells, it's a giant. Everybody's like, golly. This thing yells like an elephant or a lion. It's got force behind it. Everybody knows this was a giant, just the way it yelled. I mean, it was yelled with force. And then So we was looking around. I was taking pictures of everybody there, you know, in the group. And then and we was looking around with night vision scope all around. And then not even a minute, about 5 minutes later, this thing had traveled about 80, 90 yards. It's probably about 25 yards off of us. And it yelled real long yell. And we could eat. So what direction it was, we know what direction it was headed in. And we're pretty sure it was the giant. And then I said, well, he's coming in, you know, he's coming closer. And we was looking there for a long time for night vision scope. We couldn't find it. You know, we were looking with flashlight and everything, we could see nothing. And then we eventually started working our way out. Right there in that power line area, that oil company over. We're standing there looking around at the night vision scope, and the oil company over sees it bobbing out from the tree line, then bobbing back in the tree line, waving back and forth with his body, looking out, looking back in. And the oil company there, he's describing, his name is John Palmer, he's describing the way he's feeling the whole time. He ain't describing the Bigfoot, he's describing his reaction. He said, my hair stand up along my back, and I forget what all he was talking about and everything. And then he hands me the scope. So I start looking, and I'm looking on the right side of the ditch. There's a ditch running along to a big creek or river right there behind there. And I'm looking the right side, and then looking over to the left a little bit, but I couldn't find it. I hand him back the scope, and he couldn't find it. So we left. We come back up there the next day, and I got a picture of him. He wanted the picture. Holding a stick up, how tall he thinks it was. He held the stick up. He must have been a giant. You know, I wouldn't doubt it. Wouldn't doubt it one bit. That thing had traveled probably, you know, 70 yards, pitch black darkness, through over rivers and streams and around swamps and thick brush and everything. That thing had traveled all that far in about 5 minutes. And I don't know anything that does that.
Yeah,
no. So I'm thinking more or less the thing is nocturnal.
Were you able to capture any of those sounds? I mean, could I put them up on the website, or do you have them available?
No, I use my cell phone for call blasting and taking pictures, and you know, I didn't have recording devices at that time, and just like that one that ran alongside the interstate in Oconee County, ran for about 150 yards right alongside the interstate right there in front of my semi. I'd give my right and left arm for that if I had it on a dash cam at the time.
Yeah, no, I hear
I mean,
you.
My name had been in history books all over the world. Bigfoot video, it would have been Tony's Bigfoot video, and the classic would have been Patty's.
No, and I understand that. Your mind's not going that way to want to look over and grab your cell phone. You're too fixed on, you know, and that's pretty normal behavior.
I mean, my cell phone, I usually, my iPhone, I use a company phone. It's free calls, and it's just a cheap phone. And I have a iPhone 5S, and have iPhone 6. At the time, I think I have iPhone 5. Might have been 4, I don't know. But the thing is, I always keep my smartphone turned off. I don't use it for service. I use it for Wi-Fi, taking pictures or videos. And when I pull it out of my pocket, turn it on, because I always save battery leaving it off. I turn it on, that thing takes over a couple minutes just to turn on. And then you got to go through the apps to the video and then, you know, start shooting. And by the time, I mean, the semi I was driving, you know, and then plus, you know, on the speed, rate of speed I was and the way it was going, you know, it was, I don't know. I wouldn't even. Yeah. I wasn't even thinking about it, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, no, I hear you. And that's understandable. A lot of people, you know, especially will say in situations like...
Yeah, it's the first sighting, you know, I've actually had. And I've actually seen unidentified flying object before. And it, you know, it was about 40 foot around. It was a light, great light. And in May of 2014. But this thing right here is Bigfoot. That would be the most amazing thing I've seen was a Bigfoot.
Yeah. Well, keep your eyes and your ears peeled, especially when you're out driving. Man, I'd attach a GoPro to that windshield of yours and just have a GoPro filming constantly. But, you know, if you have anything else that happens, if you're ever out, feel free. You're always welcome back to the show. So come on back and give us an update if you've, you know, if anything new happens or if you see anything.
Yeah, I bought a GoPro and I've had, that thing had, it was GoPro Plus and I had about 600 and all the, it was a chest strap I was going to use and everything when I go hiking. And on weekends and this thing had so many settings that I said, I couldn't figure it out. I took it back. I said, this $600 ain't sitting there. Not, you know, then I actually had tree cams. That was infrared. I couldn't get them working right and took it back. But a lot of people say, you know, get them dash cams and cams for the sides of trucks and everything else. Eventually, maybe I will and get some side cameras and everything. I seen another one in Jefferson, Georgia. It's right on alongside 85. And this thing was black. It was early morning. And this thing was probably about 10 foot. It's standing alongside, it's standing right next to the, up on the bank, off the interstate a little ways. There's a lot of, about 15 foot tall pine trees along there. And it's standing right next to the pine tree. I mean, I couldn't see no facial features, nothing. All I seen was black, solid black. But this was a Bigfoot. It was standing there looking, you know, standing alongside. And I was just riding along in the semi. You know, I just had to go on, you know.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Okay, yeah. See, eventually, you say this, eventually I want to get where I can spend months out there. And then, when I first seen the one and then maybe somewhere in the time to seen the second or third one, you know, I thought about selling everything I had. You know, even getting tax money and everything, just living out there until I get close as long as video of one. I've actually had to pull back myself from not doing that. But
I don't know that I would do that.
I plan on spending my vacations out there, you know, and for weeks, you know, searching. I want to search from Atlanta all the way up into North Carolina along that stretch where I seen three. And then they actually call the one I've seen in South Carolina, actually a guy in North Carolina has seen, if not the same one, one just like it. He said when it went back in the woods, he hit his head on this tree branch. That tree branch is 10 foot tall. It come in close to his dog, and his dog chain got tied around his leg. They call it Nobby. Gave it a nickname up there in North Carolina, kind of northwest of King's Mountain, about an hour and a half. And they actually had the town go out there and look for it. They've had T-shirts and everything else painted that is finding Nobby. Well, I appreciate being on the show.
I appreciate it, too. I think that, honestly, I wouldn't quit your job to get a video of one, because a video of one, I think you're going to be disappointed pretty quick. I mean, it could be, you could have a video of one sitting there eating, you know, and having the saliva drip out of its mouth, and people will call it a fake. People will call it.
Oh, yeah.
You were a master CGI, and so most people people have a brain.
Yeah, when it's going to come to me, it's going to be end up, you know. I mean, hey, believe me, don't. That's real. It's going to be real. And they got these new things coming out, these drones and everything. I might try one of them about tax time.
Yeah. Well, let me know how that works out. I know I got a guy I'm talking to in Texas that he's using a drone, and it's a pretty advanced drone, but... let me know if you're looking at him, if you need any, want my 2 cents on it, or I can put you in touch with him, and he can give you his two. He knows a million times more than I do.
I appreciate it, man. You coming off from Washington all the way here in Georgia.
Oh, I appreciate it, Tony, and thank you so much for coming on.
All right, maybe I'll get out there sometime.
Thank you again, Tony, and thank you to the audience out there listening. Remember, if you've had an encounter, shoot me an email, wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out the website, sasquatchchronicles.com, for additional shows throughout the week. Until next time, everyone, have a great night. Someone is a human invader.